Welcome back, everyone, to the In 10 Years Time podcast. Today I'm with Chloe Gowen, Four Nations bantamweight champion.
Yes.
Four Nations bantamweight MMA champion, Chloe Gowen. Chloe, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
It's all right. I'll start off as I get my laptop. I'll start off with, so where are you from? Bristol.
Bristol, yes.
So have you lived here all your life?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me a bit more about like growing up in Bristol and all that kind of stuff?
I grew up in Yates, so like it's in Bristol, but it's like a little bit outside of Bristol. It's kind of the outskirts of Bristol. I wouldn't say like from living in Yates, I'd say it's a little bit of a rough area, but there's definitely more rougher areas in and around Bristol. But there's not much going on in Yates, to be honest. So I did a few like judo clubs down there. They had like a few clubs and that kind of introduced me into like the martial arts and stuff. And now that I've gotten a little bit older, my parents don't drive me to the training sessions. Mm-hmm. I found my local gym in like Staple Hill and I've moved out from Yates and everything. I do love Yates. I still work there, but not for me. It's kind of like, to some extent, it is a little bit of a shithole, but it is like, still home. I know it like the back of my hand.
Yeah, fair enough. You spoke earlier off camera about your brother, like when you went to judo. So how many siblings did you have? Like,
so it was just me and my brother. I'm the oldest sibling. There's like there's a year and 10 months between us. So we're quite close in age. We started judo, well, my parents chucked us both in when I was like 8, so he would have been like 6, 7, something like that. They chucked us both in, I feel like, more for his benefit, because like his ADHD and everything, I think they wanted to just get him into a sport, like run off some energy and stuff like that. And then I just found to have loved it as well, so I kind of, it worked out like chucking me into the sport as well as my brother, so I do have to thank my brother to some extent for being a little shit when we were younger, so
yeah,
it worked out.
You gotta thank them sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
As hard as it can be.
It does. I feel like we fight each other harder than any other sparring session. It's war all the time. It's war.
How was school for you?
It was good. I feel like I'm somewhat of an academic to some extent. Like, I feel like in school, like during my GCSEs and stuff like that, growing up, I was very like switched on, like always do my homework, never like gets told off and stuff like that. And then I think when I started to like progress into like my A levels, it kind of just got a bit boring for me. And then after I finished my A levels, took a gap year and like went traveling for a bit. And I'm glad I didn't just jump into uni like every single other person. I was like one of maybe like 4 or 5 people that didn't go to university. And like looking back now, I'm so glad that I didn't go to uni and I didn't do the whole studying thing, because I didn't know what I wanted to do. I would have wasted so much money. I would have been like student debt and everything like that. So
tell me about it.
Yeah. So I live with a few students and like everyone that I know has all been to uni and they're like, yeah, pay for this, cheap, broke student. So I live the student life through them. Like did Freshers Week with everybody, but I still worked a full-time job after like I did my gap year.
Bad.
So yeah, I did the student life without all the fucking hassle and all the lectures and all of the brokenness. So I'm glad I did what I did after A-levels. Yeah. And I don't think I could see myself ever going to uni. So yeah. I'm glad I played it the way I played it, to be fair.
Where'd you go traveling?
I went to Asia for like 6 weeks or so. Nice. I like saved up. I like worked my ass off in Costa for like months and months. Like didn't really have a break off so that I could pay to go to like, went to Japan, Thailand, Bali, India, and Laos. And I loved it. I had absolutely a sick time. So yeah. Would love to go traveling again, but it is very expensive.
You explained how you got into judo a little bit, but how did you get into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu then?
I feel like I kind of got into the Jiu-Jitsu through the MMA more so. I've done like judo since I was 8, went through like all the ranks till I was maybe like 16, 17, and then my dad saw like an MMA gym, and like judo, I love the sport. It's still like my home sport, like what I grew up with, but it's very like political to some extent. Like I feel like me and my brother were beating the top girls and boys like within the country. And sometimes you wouldn't get selected for things. Like funding isn't very good. Funding still isn't very good in MMA now, but it wasn't like sitting right with me anymore. I felt like I'd done it so long. I was like bored to some extent and just kind of like done out with it. So we found our local MMA gym, which I still train at now. And then, yeah, from there, just kind of like kicked off, did like some wrestling sessions, did some like jiu-jitsu sessions, and then kind of just built piece by piece. And then I've always loved like groundwork, doing judo and stuff like that, whereas my brother was very much like loved the throws striking throws and all of that sort of stuff. So I've jiu-jitsu sat a little bit better with me, especially with the groundwork and like the submissions and all of that. And it's very technical, it's a very technical sport. So yeah, that sat with me, and I haven't really like looked back since, to be fair.
Because when you hear about most guys doing, or girls doing MMA, they normally, and they're former jiu-jitsu players, normally jiu-jitsu is their base, and then they do MMA and they have to work on all the other stuff. But you, it's like you went from judo. Into MMA,
and found the jiu-jitsu through it. Like, there is some submissions in judo and stuff like that, but like no leg throws, no like leg locks and stuff. So I feel like that was all like a new spectrum for me. Like, somebody shooting a double leg on me like the first day in jiu-jitsu, I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, can't throw a double leg in judo. So yeah, it was new, but I feel like judo was such a good base, especially like with the, knowing where the weight is for like throwing and stuff like that. Like, it was a good base, I think, for MMA. Like, I don't regret not doing judo. I would have loved to have striked when I was younger, just to be like, I watched some of the guys who've like grown up and like they've boxed since they were younger, like my age was like same age as I did judo, and it's kind of like natural to them, whereas I've had to like work a little bit more harder on like my striking and stuff. So, but you can't have it both ways, I guess.
Cool. And is your nickname is Beefcake?
Yeah.
why Beefcake? That's quite a very specific.
It's a funny story, to be honest. I've never had a nickname. Well, my dad used to nickname me Boom Boom in judo, and like, and all growing up, like, he used to like being like embroidered on my belts and my gi, and like his meaning behind it was like the first boom is like you throwing them, and the second boom is like you them landing on the floor. And I thought that was pretty cool, but like, I don't know, I've grown up with it so long, my friends used to take the piss at school and all sorts, and I've never really had a nickname through like MMA or anything. Like, some things have gone and come. Like, I feel like you can't choose a nickname. Like, a nickname chooses you. And I was at the Four Nations, and I was with Mitch, my coach, and then Kian, which was one of Mitch's friends who like helped corner as well. And like, I was warming up with him on the first day, and as I was like in my like no gi stuff, and Kian turned to me and he was like, look at the back on her, she's like a fucking beefcake, mate. Like, I work so hard on my back, like, and I can't even train like that. And Mitch is like, yeah, she lifts like so heavy, like she'd embarrass you in the gym. And then he just nicknamed me Beefcake, and like, I feel like that set it off like the first day, and I thought it was really funny. I thought it was like, it sat quite well as well, like in a weird way. And then from there, like, every time I see Kian, he's like, right, Beefcake. And then from there, I just set it up on Tapology, and then we've been smooth running with Beefcake.
That's right. Yeah, on Tapology. That's a shout.
I thought it was quite funny, to be fair, and now all my housemates say it. They're like, if I win something, they're like, go Beefcake. So yeah, it's stuck now, to be fair.
Shout out to Tapology.
Yes, yeah, Tapology. Shout out to Kian for even thinking of it in the first place. Like, Beefcake's a funny
one. It is, and it's good as well, because I bet you
no one's ever
else.
Had Beefcake. No. Yeah, and I was speaking to my girlfriend about it, and obviously you've got Meatball Molly McCann, and like, I feel like Beefcake sits quite well in that like stupidity, like, but yeah, it's a good nickname. Like, you feel like you've got all these standard nicknames, but Beefcake is unique. Yeah, I like it. So
you're also you're not just doing MMA, you're also a level 3 PT, personal trainer.
Yeah.
So how are you balancing that, between that and, obviously I know you probably want to go into MMA professionally at some point, but how are you balancing that between your work life and the training?
It's a lot. I'm busy constantly, like, especially with work at the moment. I coach as like a franchisee for a martial arts business for kids as well. So it's very long days, but I'd love to like quit my admin job. My manager knows this anyway, so it's not even like I'm like outing myself here. I'd love to leave my admin job, just like free up like 30-40 hours in the week, and then like fully pursue PTing, like, and coaching clients and stuff. Like, I have a few clients like here and there that I just kind of like slot into like different days, but like, I'd love to go just like full steam ahead and just PT constantly, like coach and be in the gym and then like train myself and like do all of those extra things. So currently it's like a little bit smaller. Before I took on this like franchisee job, I was PTing a little bit more, but like, it's kind of slightly on the back burner, but like, I know it's in like my repertoire for like when I like go pro, I can just start like handing out clients, and fingers crossed I can get a few clients and go from there. But yeah, it's busy constantly. My life's busy as fuck.
And is that something, once you go professional, you're not going to do that then at all, or are you going
to
like...
I'd like to think I would. Like, you can't train constantly all the time. I love being in the gym, and like, I found like a weird rewarding factor with like coaching. So I'll coach and like seeing somebody like go out and like do a technique that you taught them like in the gym or like a competition. It's kind of like, it's a small satisfaction to it. So I quite enjoy coaching to an extent. So I'd like to think that I'd maybe take on a couple of PTs and like fully PT them and then like see them grow and then see where it goes. But yeah, I can't wait for the free time that I have, like, just training full time. Like, you can train in the morning, train in the evening, a few TTs here and there, and then have the time to like go home and do all like the chores that I don't have time to do in like the week and stuff like that. Like a simple life, I feel like it would be. It probably won't be like that when it comes to being pro, but I'd like to think it would be a much more simpler life than what I have right now. So
fair enough.
We'll see.
Also, when you did an interview that you did earlier in the year, I think it was with English MMA before, like when you got selected. I saw loads of guitars in like your room. So are you an avid guitar player?
I funnily enough, my dad's now a guitarist. Oh. I was using his
I was going to say, are you using someone else's?
Yeah, my dad's got a huge like music, like guitars all across the room. Like he collects big like speakers. Like he wants like orange speakers like across. He loves his music and stuff like that. So like, I'd like to think I'm a good guitarist, but... No, yeah, my dad's the guy to speak to about it, 100%. Joe asked me the same question on the interview. He's like, you love all these guitars, he's like, do you play? And I was like, no, I should have picked a better room, really. I should have like put some other stuff up. But yeah, the guitars was a cool background, to be fair. So shout out to my dad for that. But
going on to your MMA career now, you're training at Impact Gym. You mentioned Mitch. He's also, you got signed this year to Cage Warriors
as
well.
Yes, he did.
How did you get involved with Impact Gym, first off?
I probably started when I was maybe like 17, so a few years back now. And my dad was kind of looking into some MMA gyms. He's like, loves the thought of MMA and like all the, like the proper fighting kind of styles and stuff. And he, like a couple friends suggested it to him, like Jake and Tom now run the gym, the O'Hagans, but their dad like initially like started up the gym, and like my dad's heard a lot of like good things about him, and he's like a tough guy, like completely known around Bristol. So the fact that his sons were now running it, he thought it was a good gym to go to, and I went, and there's no egos to it, like all the guys know what they're doing, they're like so friendly, and especially being like one of maybe like three or four females that are on the mat, like for me it was key to not like have any like weird guys on the mat to like some extent. Like you do get it at some gyms, like I know with some jiu-jitsu gyms, they don't have like female changing rooms and like stupid shit like that. So to go to a gym and like feel like all the guys are like family, like that's the perfect atmosphere for me, and they all train hard. Like there's nothing worse than going to a gym wanting to train and then like everyone's like chatting on the mat and like stuff like that. Like it does bug me to an extent, but like everyone's here to train, we all train, and then like if you want to go have like a pint after, we can all go have a pint and like chill after. So yeah, it just fit, and then it stuck from there. Like I've been to a couple of other gyms around Bristol to like train, but nothing's got like the same atmosphere as like what I found at Impact Gym. So I think I have found a place there.
How difficult did you find when you went from judo to MMA, how difficult did you find that transition? Because obviously you got to learn up all the stand-up stuff as well.
It was hard and not hard at the same time. Like I feel like the grappling came really easily, but like you said, the striking was a little bit harder. Like I did striking for maybe like 6 to 8 months, like just in the sessions, and then the striking coach over there, Paul, I started doing some PTs with him, and it was only just recently I looked back on like the first ever PT that I did with him, and my stand-up was so shit. Like I honestly I look back and like I kind of like follow him around the mat, like the head movement isn't there, the footwork isn't there, but like PTing with him just kind of like went from here, and it just kind of like skyrocketed my like striking up. So like I think throwing myself in the deep end with the striking helped a lot, rather than just tiptoeing and being like, oh, I'm just gonna be like a grappler, like MMA fighter. So it was, yeah, I think the stand-up was hard, and like getting punched in the face a few times at the start, like that takes its toll, you know, if you're like, you're not like getting anywhere, but then you work on one thing, then maybe you like land a nice punch and striking, and you're like, oh, like it's kind of, I feel like it's more satisfying than like hitting a nice throw or like a nice armbar. Like if I hit a nice jab, I'm like, oh, I know I'm getting better now. So yeah, the striking was a little bit hard, especially like right at the start, getting like punched in the face, or like nice like liver shot and getting dropped a few times. Those were the rough times, rough times in the gym, but I've worked through. I feel like I'm not a striking expert by no means, but I'm definitely getting better, so it's promising.
And in that Four Nations final, I actually thought your striking was actually a lot better.
Thank you.
And also your opponent, she was Welsh actually. I don't know if you noticed, because the commentators were saying this, that did you notice that her leg was that bad?
Yes.
You did notice
I remember watching it back, and like the commentators were like, I don't know if she knows her leg's hurt. Yeah. And I was like shouting at my own screen watching it. I was like, I did know. Like,
She switched to southpaw, didn't she?
Yes, she did. We watched her. Hayley went through 3 days of fighting. She did the Friday fight as well. And we watched the Friday fight, and it was a tough fight. I feel like she'll honestly, like, we're friends anyway. Like, we train like affiliate gyms anyway. And she was fighting a kickboxer, and the kickboxer did smash her leg up pretty bad.
Right,
I was watching it, and I was like, oh, that's pretty rough. And then she pulled out a submission out of the bag, like, fair play. Like, she pulled out. I think she needed to pull it out. Otherwise, I don't think she would have won based on decision. So I watched that, and we watched her limp out on the Friday. So we were like, okay, well, we know we're not going to meet till the finals anyway if that does happen, so she still has to get through the next day. And she pulled out a quick submission on the second day as well, so I was like, okay, but we knew her leg was not right. And I've worked so hard on like fighting southpaw and like kicking on like a good outside leg, and I've been like, it's been working really well in the gym. So like, as soon as I came out on round one, I just started like smashing the leg, and I could see
it was
like
swelling up.
It was swelling up, and like every time I'd hit it, she'd like limp, or like when she'd go to step forward, it was just a little bit more stiffer than usual. And then when she made that adjustment in round two to like go southpaw, I knew like her leg was pretty bad, 100%. So I did know to some extent. Yeah, as unlike the commentators say.
Yeah. So is that what the striking then? Obviously, I know you'll go do all different kinds of martial arts at the moment, but is the striking the main one you're looking at to improve the most?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, 100%. Like everything, this is a lot more technical than I thought. I thought it would just be like you learn the punches and then you go from there, but. Yeah, I definitely want to improve that, and then hopefully be more well-rounded fighter. So,
Obviously, so far it's been amateur fights, and I know quite often people do like 10 or something or whatever amateur fights before they go pro. How many more amateur fights do you think you'll do?
That's the question, isn't it? I've been asked a few
just
times
like a rough
now.
Like estimate.
I want to hit 10. I want to hit 10 and 0. I think that would be like nice round numbers. I don't feel like the females ever get to 10 and 0. I feel like there's not enough females to fight to some extent.
Yeah.
I've obviously got the Worlds coming up. There's potential. There's definitely 3 fights, potentially 4 fights on the card. So I think that would jump me straight up to the get-go. And then there's a potential for a title fight in May next year. So like hopefully 4 fights, and then tick that one off, and then I definitely pro next year. So
pro next year. Definitely.
I want to say definitely, but Mitch might be like watching this back and being like, shut the fuck up, we're gonna do one more year and then you can go through. So we'll see how it plays out. I'm gonna leave it in Mitch's ballpark.
And what weight? Because you normally you do it at 115, but you did the four nations at 135.
Yeah.
So you jumped
big
up
jump, two. Yeah.
So 125. We can.
I think if I was to go pro day before weigh in, I'd do straw weight. I think.
What, so 115?
Yeah, 100%. Okay. Like the same as my championship fight in March. It was day before weigh-ins, so we made straw weight quite well, to be fair. I hadn't seen 52 kilos in like years and years and years. And then I made the weight and I felt good. So I think straw weight would be the championship weight, hopefully.
Because you did really well, like I said, in that final. But she definitely, Hayley, did have a big advantage. You did really good to get over it.
Yeah, both girls. The girl on the first day was like world-class kickboxer, like Lauren she was fucking tall. My striking was like, my angles were really good in the first couple of rounds, and then it came to the third round, I think it got a bit more tired and she punched me in the face quite a few times. I think 63, it was the reach for me. Like, I knew I'd be just as strong as the girls, but it was it's definitely the height factor,
isn't it?
It was a struggle. I'm short, so it was definitely a struggle.
You mentioned your coach, Mitch Good. Mm-hmm. Obviously, he's recently signed to Cage Warriors. Mm-hmm. Do you know, is that the kind of route you want to go down, like the whole Cage Warriors Academy thing and then the Cage Warriors?
I'd like to think so.
Because that's what he did.
Yeah, he did. He got both the belts, two weights on the Academy, and then he hasn't even had his pro debut
no,
yet.
He just got
straight signed to Cage Warriors. So, big respect to him. But he took the. He's taken the same route as what I'm taking now. He did the Euros, he did the Worlds. So it's been nice to have a coach that's already done half of those things, to be like, you need to preserve your energy on this day. Like, this is like the strategy behind it. So it's definitely how it helped in the Four Nations, having him like be like, this is what you're gonna do this day, you're just gonna preserve it. Like, there's no need to rush for a finish, like you still have a fight the next day. So I'd like to think I'll do the Worlds, tick that off. I'd like to have a fight on the Cage Warriors Academy. I was scheduled to have one last year, but it fell through. So whether it happens or not, I guess we'll see. But again, I've got a foot in with Mitch, so hopefully he can like win the pro debut, sweet talk them and be like, yeah, you should sign Chloe as well. So we'll see.
That's good. What was I going to say? What is it about you that sets you apart from other fighters? Like, why do you think you'll be more successful than others?
That's a tough question. I hate to say it, but like there's an ego to fighting to some extent. You have to have an ego to fight. I say it to like so many people and I'm like, you don't have to be a dickhead with an ego, but like
But nice guys finish last.
Yeah, 100%. Like you need to know you're the best in the best in the room, best in the gym, best in the fight. Like if you go into a fight half ass, you won't win the fight. Like you could be better than them technically, you could be stronger, but if in your head you think you're gonna lose, I just have that mindset that you will lose, and I don't like losing. I feel like I go in the gym, I tick off what sessions that I want to do, and I want to be the best. Like I know in my mind, like I want to be the first three-weight UFC champ. Like I want to set like big goals that like nobody's ever done, and like I don't think I'll be like satisfied until like I've ticked everything off, and then I can actually sit down, relax, and be like, well, I've done everything that I want to do in my life, and now I can start like progressing to different avenues and like coaching or like whatever life takes me. But like in my head, I think I know what I want to do, and like if I don't do it, I don't think I'll be happy when the time comes. So we'll see how it goes. But
lost my train of thought. Oh yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. A couple more questions. Who's your favorite UFC fighter at the moment? And second one. I always ask people similar sports, like, who do you think is going to win this, whatever? Who do you think is going to win Aspinall versus Pavlovich? I try not to take your bias, because I know I want
like
Tom.
Aspinall, yeah.
Yeah, I know. I know.
I don't know. I want to say Tom. I think Tom will win that. Like,
I think he
would as well, to be fair. Like, that's not even me just picking bias, because, like, I like Tom. He's a character as well. And I think he'll go to win it, and then I think he'll go to win against John. If it comes to it, like I think John's like just torn his pec or something.
I think they should do him versus John in Wembley or something.
That would be sick. I think like a big like London show would be absolutely would sell out, and I would absolutely love that. But I think Tom could pull out of the bag. Like he's got that mindset. He really does. Like I've seen all of his interviews and stuff, and he doesn't want to fuck about with any drinking. He doesn't want he's in the gym constantly. He trains and he knows what he wants to do. So I hopefully Tom pulls that out of the bag. Sorry, what was your second question?
Favorite fighter, UFC fighter.
It used to be Joanna Jędrzejczyk when I was younger, like growing into it, and like Ronda Rousey and stuff like that. I don't know who my favorite fighter would be at the moment. That's a tough question. I love I think Rose is kind of out of the UFC now, but like Rose was like a big favorite. Yeah, 100%. Like I think she could have been one of the best. 100%. But Zhang Weili.
She's my favorite.
She's my favorite. Yeah, she really is. Like I don't know. The guys, there's like such a broad spectrum. I like a lot of the like lightweight guys, like Justin Gaethje, Michael Chandler, like all the characters. I love all of those. But Zhang Weili just has like a sweet little place. Like I feel like I've said it so many times before, if I had to fight like Zhang Weili like on a strawweight card, I don't think I could even like beef her or like chat shit in front of her, because she would just be so nice. She'd be like, well, thank you for fighting me. And I'd be like, oh, I don't want to punch you in the face anymore, mate. It's like, but she's sweet, but absolutely vicious.
Yeah,
like,
she's in
a
the,
beast. Yeah, in she'd catch me. She'd be like, oh, so nice. And then like get in the cage with her and she'd knock me the fuck out.
Yeah,
so.
No, it's sad. When you're talking about Rose, that's a bit sad what's happened to her.
I like Rose.
I think she could have been
one of the best. I've taken a few things from her, especially her fight when she was like, I think it might have been against Joanna, especially like she was like saying prayers, I want to say, when she was in the face-off with Joanna at one point, just like keep calm. And her in the cage, I think it was with Joanna again, when she was just saying like, I'm the best, I'm the best. And I've taken that aspect from it, and I do it before every single fight. And I feel like you kind of manifest it, don't you, to some extent. I truly like believe all of that like manifestation stuff. So watching her pull that out of the bag, I wish she could have like taken it to like all the way. That would have been like nice to see for Rose, but it's a bit sad, isn't it?
Yeah, so. Oh well.
Yeah.
What is your next fight? So is it the world?
Weeks or something like that.
So it is that. So you're not... Yeah. Have you done the European?
No, they didn't do the Euros this year.
Yeah, I was going to say, because I couldn't find any.
The England... Well, I want to say many other countries, they all pulled out of the IMAF from like some allegations and stuff like that.
Yeah.
100%. So I didn't think I was going to do the Worlds or the Euros this year. I thought I'd have to maybe keep through to amateur until next year and hope that like the Euros and the Worlds came around. And we did the Four Nations, and then a message came through in our England chat saying like, we're in for the Worlds. Like, we're like, they've had like a big discussion, like some things have been cleared and everyone's in for the Worlds. So I went to a session and then yeah, got selected first pick. So we've just been full steam ahead for the Worlds. I really didn't expect to do the Worlds this year. I thought maybe tick a few more fights off this year, but yeah, the Worlds is I feel like it's going to be a good one to end on. I want to do it, win the Worlds, and then have the rest of the year off.
Yeah,
hopefully. So I think I'd be well deserved if I pull it out of the bag.
I always ask my guest this at the end of all the podcasts. In 10 years, so you're 23.
Yeah.
So 10 years time in 2032, you'll be 33.
Yes.
Where would you like to see yourself in 10 years time, both in MMA and like just
in
happiness
life.
And life
in life. I want to be the UFC champ. I feel like a lot of the guys like late 20s, maybe like 30s are like, it's weird to say like 30s are like primes for like MMA, like a lot of the champions are.
It's really weird.
Like
weird,
you think
though.
Like young 20s, like especially like you talk about gymnasts and stuff, like they're so young when they're in their prime. But I'd like to think by the time I'm 33, at least 2-weight champ, 100%. Like, I think being a female is hard in some aspects, but it's a lot easier route to get into the UFC sometimes. Like,
there's
a lot less of us, do you know what I mean? So, like, if I pull it out of the bag and beat everyone, like, there's no reason for them to like not sign me. So, especially being 23 and almost on the edge of the pro ranks anyway, I'd like to think I'm definitely signed to the UFC. Maybe two-time champ, maybe, like, looking for the third, potentially.
Two-weight or two-time?
Two-weight. And hopefully defend the belt a few times, you know. Otherwise, it's no point in being like a long-standing champ if I just pull it out of the bag. And then, I don't know, I'd love to be coaching. I want my, like, franchisee business to, like, kick out the bag so that I don't have to, like, work anymore. Like, that would be the absolute dream, you know. Who knows? I'd be, like, settled down maybe to some extent. Maybe me and my girlfriend have kids, I don't know, at 33, like something, like small things happen in like a year, let alone 10 years. So big things, I think, in 10 years time, I think my life will be like completely different. Hopefully rich, lots of money.
Well, if you're in the UFC,
nice
that's
car,
gonna help.
Yeah, that would be mint. Don't have to work a day in my life.
Dream car? You said nice car?
I don't know what my dream car would be. Like a nice Defender or something. Like I love SUVs and like big trucks. Okay. So I think it would be like that. And then maybe have like, if I'm rich, I'd have a few fucking sports cars on the side like my nice mansion with a couple cars. Nice. That would be the dream.
Nice.
100%. So we'll see how it goes. But
Chloe, thanks so much for being
so
a great
much.
Guest.
Thank you. It's
thanks
been
for making
lush.
Yeah, thanks for getting down here and everything. That's you're right. being a great
you're the
guest.
One you had to travel really, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, so. Yeah, I did have to travel, yeah. But no, thank you so much.
Thank you
Hope
so much.
Hope everything goes well
Fingers
and everything.
Crossed.
So yeah.
Thank you so much. Chloe. Cheers.